Good morning, and welcome to Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist Church Sunday School. Our subject for this morning is, Who is Trustworthy? And it's coming from John, the 7th chapter, verses 14-24. And the key verse is, He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we study your word this morning, give us the understanding of who is trustworthy. Give us the strength to do your bidding so that we know that you can trust us to do your work. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Introduction. We have been given different gifts and talents from the Lord to be used for his glory. Even when we have similar gifts, we have been given different missions to carry out according to the specific plan and purpose of God has for our lives. If there's a task he calls you to do, it's because no one else could do it exactly like you. You're unique, and so your purpose, and so is your purpose while you're here on earth. When we're living in our gifts and using them for the Lord, we can't be stopped. He always makes a way for us when we are following the path that he has set for us. This doesn't mean that we won't face challenges and roadblocks, but it does mean that God has a plan for you that can't be changed. Isn't that a relieving thought? Whatever your gift may be, you should take the time to work it up and use it to the best of your ability. For example, if it is a musical talent, practice the instrument or singing. If it's a gift for teaching, take the advantage of the opportunity to share your knowledge with others and engage in public speaking events. If it's leadership, lead whatever team you manage closer to the Lord, and even if you don't work for a Christian company. In our lesson today, Jesus amazed his audience in such a way that they complimented. And the Jews were marveled, saying, How knoweth this man letters and hath never learned? That's in John 7, chapter 14, verse. And the way you can amaze others when you live your gift according to God's will, not for the sake of accolades, that's a lot of praise that you give yourself, or earthly popularity, but for the glory of the Lord. Continue to end on your gift. In part one of our lesson, Jesus' great teachings, and I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard. About the middle of the festival, Jesus went up into the temple and began to teach. The Jews were astonished at it, saying, How does this man have such learning when he has never been taught? Then Jesus answered them, My teaching is not mine, but he is who sent me. Okay, this is what I want you to know. In the third of blessings from my unit, God Eternal Reign, and the only one from the Gospel of John, as tension among Jesus and the religious leaders heightened, Jesus is ministering in the area of Galilee. His desire was to go to Judea and to continue his work, but the Jews were looking for an opportunity to kill him. You know, you have people that don't like seeing you doing a good job, especially when you're working for the Lord, and they have a way of trying to aim to get rid of you or try to harm you. And Jesus knew this, and this is why he did not go to Judea when his disciples asked him to. His brothers asked him to leave the area of Galilee and to go to Judea instead. It was during the festival of booths, And Jesus takes their lives and he tells them that the world will hate them as he is already hated for testifying against the evil work they are doing. As you read and study this lesson, think of a time in which you know God has given you an assignment, but there were those who objected your word. How would you respond? Were you able to complete your assignment on task despite their rejection and opposition? Jesus did. Okay, the festival of booths is what the Israelites did when they come out of Egypt. They were supposed to build a booth and dwell in that booth for 7 days. And this was after they had exited Egypt. And this is to remind them to keep God first in their life and to worship him, because he was the one that brought them out of Egypt. And it was supposed to last for 7 days while they were after they come out from Egypt in slavery. So that's what they call the Festival of Booths. And they were happy that they were going to the Promised Land. Okay? Have we ever truly been gifted by God and seek to do God's will as he directs? You will amaze others. Therefore, do any task as so as to satisfy the one who assigned it, and worry less about your accusers or haters. They are there to keep you praying. After much discussion with his brothers in Galilee, Jesus decided that he would not attend the festivals of booths, which reminds the Israelites when they left Egypt and did not have a home to live in. Instead, they were nomads traveling from place to place under the guidance of God as he led them with a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of clouds by day. Okay? Jesus knew that they were not to kill in Judea, and Jews was a part of his family. So even if you got family members that know that you're trying to do good, they still will seek a way to pull you down, destroy you, make you look bad among people. And because they won't have it, because you were talking about what they were doing, their sins. Like if they were drinking liquor, smoking dope, or hanging out in the streets all types of hours of the night with nothing to do. And he come along and said, this is not right. You're supposed to be in the house. You're supposed to stop doing that, because what you're doing, like drinking milk and smoking dope, is harmful to your body, and your body is a temple of God. They were getting mad at it, and they were getting mad at you. So that's why Jesus knew that if he go to Judea, that they would be out. In verse 14, it tells that Jesus changed his mind. His mind about attending the festival. Instead, he went on the fourth day, and the festival lasted 7 to 8 days. This is probably the first time Jesus spoke in a temple setting. Okay? Part 2, Jesus is in Judea now. Already sneaked into Judea, and he's in the temple. And he teaches for God. You find this in John, the 7th chapter, the 17th through the 20th verse. And I'm reading the New Revised Standard. Anyone who resolves to do the will of God will know whether the teaching is from God or whether I am speaking on my own. Those who speak on their own seek their own glory. But the ones who seek the glory of him who sent him is true, and there is nothing false in him. Did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keep the law. Why are you looking for an opportunity to kill me? This was Jesus talking. And the crowd answered, you have a demon who is trying to kill you. In other words, what this is saying, those that who go out and do the will of God and know that they have been called by God to do his teaching and bidding, they know that it's true. And those who speak on their own will, their own love, say, Lord, if I've been called by Jesus and I know I'm a preacher, and they get out there and use the word, his word, and use it for their own gain, and they be boasting and bragging about they can do this and they can do that, but really, they're not really set, they're not really called of God, but they're just using that title to give accolades for people to, you know, say, well, Lord, you did a good job this morning. You preached that word, knowing that you didn't preach the word because it wasn't what God has written. You preached it so it will satisfy those that's sitting in the audience that don't want to do right, to continue doing wrong. But if God has called you to teach his word, preach his word, and do his bidding, you will know it because the Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you, and then you won't have to worry about not doing what God tells you to do. But then those people that's sitting around listening to you speak God's word, they're going to hate you because you're telling them that this is wrong, that is wrong, and you need to get your life straightened out and your house in order because what you're doing is not pleasing in God's sight. And that they will try every way they can to hide around the corner somewhere and wait till you come and jump you and beat you up or try to shoot you or try to bring some food to the house that's not seasoned right. It might have a little rat poison in it and they might try to kill you. So this is what Jesus is telling. It's not me. I'm coming from, the word is coming from my Father. And they say, he said, he asked them, why are you trying to kill me? And they said, no, we're not trying to kill you. You have a demon that's trying to kill you. Yes, Satan will try to kill you, but his imps, the people that you're talking about, are the ones that's trying to get rid of you. They are the demons, not you. And long as you keep on preaching the word, studying the word, doing what's right, Satan will have somebody somewhere trying to snatch you down. And when he gets you down, you feel like you can't get up. But don't worry, God has got you. You're teaching his word and God's going to look out for you. In response to their amazement, this is what Jesus proclaimed. My document is not mine, but of he that sent me. And they did not understand this. In other words, people don't understand what you're trying to say. And they, when you tell them that, I didn't say it. God gave me the word to tell you. But they still don't want to believe it. And they didn't understand this saying. They thought he was the son of a carpenter. No, he was son of the Most High God and son of Mary. Joseph was his earthly father, but he had nothing to do with him coming into this world. God sent a spirit to Mary and overcame Mary, and that's how Mary became the mother of Jesus. She was impregnated by the Holy Spirit. And that's why Jesus was born in human form. Okay? Be mindful. Jesus' initial reason for not attending the festival was because the religious leaders were angry with him and they wanted to kill him. But here, Jesus is in their midst, further blowing their minds, probably drawing more attention to himself. In his teaching, it must be varied not to reserve just one topic, thereby causing the crowd to wonder, where did Jesus acquire such truth about the look about God, the law, and other biblical teachings? Jesus wanted them to know that this depth of teaching could not have come from his earthly father, Joseph. Neither could it have come from any other school of thought. It would have come from his heavenly father. This would resonate the words of the prophet Isaiah, as Jesus' thoughts are God's thoughts. His ways are God's ways. His teaching is not his own, but to gather those of, but all to gather those of who sent him. In other words, these thoughts were not Jesus' thoughts. His earthly father, Joseph, was a carpenter, so he couldn't teach him what God wanted him, what Jesus, to tell the world. His thoughts come from his heavenly father. And when you, you listen to your heavenly father, he will tell you what to say. When you read his word, he'll tell you in his word what to give people, to let them know that I am that I am. He will tell you which direction to go when you're traveling wrong. And this is what Jesus was trying to tell the people of Judea, the Jews, that it's not my words. Joseph didn't give them to me. They come from my Father who sits in heaven and the Holy Spirit. And they didn't want to believe me. They didn't want to take him at his word because they felt like that. He was too young to know about the law that Moses was given by God. He was too young to know about what they should be doing and what they shouldn't be doing. But Jesus got direct orders from his heavenly Father. And when he got direct orders from his heavenly Father, he had to do as he was told to do. So whenever you hear a voice telling you, especially if you go get ready to do something you know you ain't got no business doing, and this voice tell you, don't do that, or don't go that way, listen to that voice because it's trying to keep you from getting in trouble or running up into danger. Sometimes on the highways, you might be traveling, and you hear this voice say, don't go that way, because there's a wreck. There's a cop sitting on the side waiting for a speeding. You listen to that voice. You find another way to go to get to where your destination is. And when you get past that area, then you will hear on the radio. But there was a wreck on Highway 40 between Wake Avenue and Hill Street. Then you say, well, that's the reason why I didn't go that way. That's the reason why I got the word not to travel that route. So listen to that voice and let it lead you and guide you. Okay? Part three, Jesus justifies his word. New Revised Standard. And Jesus answered them, I performed one word and all of you are astonished. Moses gave you circumcision. It is, of course, not from Moses, but from the patriarchs, and you are circumcised as a man on the Sabbath. If a man receives circumcision on the Sabbath in order that the law of Moses may not be broken, you are angry with me because I healed a man's body. Wait a minute. Are you angry with me because I healed a man's whole body on the Sabbath? Do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment. Okay? It says, sometimes you seek to do God's will for your life. You will have those who will falsely accuse you. Continue to stand firm on your God-given task by having humility throughout to prove you true. But one cannot truly do God's will unless you know that it's God's will. Therefore, Jesus said, if any man do his will, they will be able to validate my teaching and my deeds. You will also know that I am not doing my will, but the will of him that sent me. In other words, Jesus is saying, if you continue to do what God tells you to do, you are doing it in truth, and that you will know that it is God's will. And if any man do his will, they will be able to validate his teaching and his deeds. This is saying that if you continue to do God's will, the teaching that Jesus has taught, Israel is supposed to follow this law. Since Jesus had not been hung on the cross yet, he followed this law also. But he was also teaching God's word and doing God's will. And he let me know that I'm not doing my will, but the will of him that sent me. He was not doing his will. God's will is that you do what is right. You do what he tells you to do, and not what man tells you to do. Even when you're on your job, and if your supervisor tells you that you got to do this, and you feel like it's not right, you listen to that still voice, but do what God tells you to do. And then in a roundabout way, do it the way it should be done. And when your supervisor comes back, he or she will realize that you did the job, but it wasn't the way they told you to do it. They might have told you to do it a quick and easy way, but you did it the right way so that client, that person that you're working with, will not get hurt. So continue to do God's will, and he will let you know whether you're doing right or wrong. Jesus was giving them a foolproof way to determine his authenticity and his authority. As one seeks to do God's will, it is God who will validate the truth of their efforts. Second, if one's teaching does not match God's principle or correlate with God's truth, then you will know it is not of God. In other words, if God tells you to do something, and you don't do it the way God told you to do it, he's going to let you know. Because he's going to punish you in such a way that you're going to wish that you hadn't done it the way he told you to. He will let you know that that's not what I told you to do. And for that, you're going to be punished. And how your punishment is going to come, it might be sickness. It might be what you can't do for yourself. You have to have somebody else to come in and do what God asked you to do. It might be death. Either way, if you disobey God and don't follow his command, he will punish you. He will make you realize that I should have done what God told me to do, I would be in this predicament. He might bring trouble in your home because you didn't follow his way. He might take your children, and one of them might get locked up or in a wreck or locked up and get sick. But if you correct your ways and do what God asks you to do, you will see a difference in your household. You'll see a difference in your children. You will see a difference in the way, your way of living. And this is pleasing God. So whatever God tells you to do, follow his will, not your will, because your will will lead you down the wrong path. Jesus further expounds on this as he tells them that he is not working on his own agenda. Jesus didn't have an agenda of his own. He had an agenda of God. Neither does Jesus need to lift himself up or looking for any glory. Jesus didn't ask to be praised or gifted up. He didn't tell people, well, I'm going to show you this, and this is how you're going to praise me. You're going to give me all the glory. No. Jesus did, and he tells the people, whoever he healed or whatever that ailment was, he would tell them, go tell no man. But what they do, somebody that got healed will go back and say, come see a man. He told me this and he told me that and he healed me. Or he would tell them, go show the elders in the temple. And the man that was standing out there by the pool, beautiful, that hadn't walked for years, he got up and walked into the temple, and they asked him, what are you doing walking? Wasn't you the one that sat out there by the pool waiting for the pool to move? And he said, yes, but how are you walking? Jesus healed me. But they didn't believe him. So Jesus stepped in and asked, was this man born a cripple? And they said, yes. All right, there he is. I didn't heal him, but my father did. So he wasn't looking for nobody. He wasn't looking to toot his own horn, as the people would say. people. You don't do it for them and go out and brag and say, well, yeah, I did this and I did that and I carried them something to eat or I carried them downtown or I carried them shopping. You don't do that for your glory. When you do it, you let people say, well, you know, I was sitting here and I was so hungry, I didn't know what to do. And then they were knocking on the door. And lo and behold, there was Mother so-and-so and Deacon John. They come in here, they brought me vegetables, they brought me meats, they brought me milk, I brought me plenty of food to put in my cabinet so I won't go hungry. You know, God is good, because he knows when to step in right in on time. And Lord, I so thank you for them folks, because they were good to me. You don't hear that nowadays. People are do, and they be boasting and bragging what they do. If you want God to give you praise, you do it to praise for the glory of God. And then he will lift you up. He will let people see that you are his child and that you are doing good and that you are doing what he tells you to do. He tells you to go out, feed the sick, visit those that's locked up in jail, help those that's homeless, clothe them that need clothes. This is what God is telling you to do. And Jesus did it while he was on this earth. So, as Jesus continued to work, he compares his ability to keep the law and commandment of the ones that sent him and to Moses who gave him the law. But see, the people back there, they didn't abide by the law. They were doing what they wanted to do. They felt like they could do it and get by with it and not be punished. But then when Jesus come along, they wanted to hurt him because he was doing what is right. But as the day go by, this is what I want you to remember. In the early years of Jesus' ministry, it was his teaching, healing, preaching, and miracles that brought great fame and notoriety to him. It was not that he desired to be famous, but he sought to do the will of God. In other words, Jesus was doing what he was sent on earth to do. He was sent to teach, heal, preach, and do miracles, and not to do it for fame. Not to do it for people to notice him, because he will always disappear amongst the crowd to get away from people looking for him to try to hurt him. But Jesus is doing the will of God, and this is what we need to do. Although we can't heal people like Jesus did, but you can pray for the healing. We can't do miracles like Jesus did, but you could pray for God to perform a miracle. And when he performed this miracle, you could say it was nobody but God. Look at God. See how God works. This is what Jesus was trying to teach the people back there in his days. I'm not doing it for my will, but for the will of my Father. And he's not trying to gain popularity. He refused to let the Pharisees view the work on the Sabbath to prevent him from doing his Father's will. We must seek to do as Jesus did. On the Sabbath day, you weren't supposed to do no type of work. You weren't supposed to feed the cattle. You weren't supposed to work in the garden. You weren't supposed to cook. I remember back in the days where they had the blue law. And the blue law was there would be no stores open on Saturday, on Sunday. If you didn't get it Saturday, you was out of luck on Sunday. There was no, you won't do it, you won't supposed to cut no grass, wash your cars, water the yard, you supposed to rest. Because the Sabbath day is for rest. God made the world, and on the Sabbath day, he rests. So this is what the Sabbath day was meant to be, rest. You go to church, you fellowship with God, and you go back home. My grandmother would always cook her Sunday dinners on Saturday. And then when she got back home, she would warm it up, we would sit down, and we would eat. And that would be it. We would go outside and we would play with children, or you were adults, you would sit in the house and you sit down and watch TV or have a conversation with your visitors that's come up. So the Sabbath day is supposed to be kept holy. This is why Jesus was trying to teach them that on the Sabbath day, I still can do God's work because I'm not working in the field, but I'm here. I'm teaching. I'm letting people know that God is who he is, and I'm doing his will. And as you go through this week, I want you to hear, as you study this lesson, pick up your Bible and go to John, the 7th chapter, read the whole 7th chapter. If not, read the whole book of John and get a better understanding of this lesson. And you will see what Jesus was trying to tell the Jews back there in his days. And know that God has a gift for all of us to use, whether it's singing, preaching, playing the piano, teaching, someone, showing somebody how to do this, how to do that. Use your gift that God has given you. And when you use it, he will make you greater and multiply when you do better and help somebody else along the way. If you know how to fish, teach somebody how to fish so they will know how to eat. If you know how to sew, show somebody how to sew or make a dress up. Next time, they can make one on their own. If you know how to cook, if somebody asks you, well, show me how to make this, how to cook this, carry me in the kitchen, get the bowl out, let them put the ingredients in the bowl and tell them how to stir it up and put it in the pan and what temperature to put it on to make sure it don't burn. Teach them, use your gift. If you know how to sing, sing a song to somebody that's laying in the rest home that can't sing, but they enjoy hearing the music, hearing the hymns. If you know how to play a saxophone, a tuba, a flute, use your gift. It'll make somebody know that God is still on the throne and that he is still listening and he's looking out for you. Use your gift wisely, because if you don't, you're going to lose it. And this is what I want you to share. Share with people that you're about to do, you're doing God's will. And you don't want no glory, you want them to give God the glory. Because if it has not been for God giving you the gift to use, to do his will, then you wouldn't be able to do what he asked you to do. And you wouldn't be able to help God get the glory. Give them people, do like Jesus. If you fed somebody and they said, I thank you, tell them no, thank God, because if it had not been for God, I wouldn't have been able to do for you. Now, you do for somebody else and you pass the gift on, because if you hold on to it, it won't do you no good. You're going to lose it. But pass your gift on to somebody else so they can help somebody else, so they can help somebody else, and the will of God will continue to be carried out. And that's all I have to say. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what you have taught us today. And we thank you for letting us know that it's not our will, but your will be done. And that we have to use the gift that you have given us to teach others and let them know that you get the glory and not man on earth. Father, we thank you for Jesus. And we thank you for letting him use his gift to do your will, to teach others that you sent him to do what you have taught him to do, and that he got it from you, and that he's passing it on to us so that we can continue to do your will. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Next Sunday's lesson will be the final subject in this book, and it's Judge Not. And you'll find it in John, the 8th chapter. Read the whole chapter of John to get a better understanding of this lesson. And the key verse, the main thought is, she said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. So read John, the 8th chapter, and be on judgment. Judge not. And stay tuned for our morning service for Dr. Reverend Wimp Gallagher.